Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening. Welcome to this Microsoft Virtual Academy online course. And today we're going to take a look at the Microsoft Hybrid Cloud. And we're going to take a quick introduction into that cloud and some of the things that you need to consider when you're thinking about using clouds with your environment today. My name is Matt Hester. I'm a senior IT pro evangelist with Microsoft. You can reach me on my blog at aka.ms/Matt Hester. So what are we going to look at in this particular presentation? We're going to talk about what does it mean to be a hybrid cloud environment, and why is it important, and why now do we look at this, and what are some of the components that are a part of the hybrid cloud? And chances are, folks, you probably already have some of these components deployed in your environment today. And then we'll end with a brief demonstration of some of the great things that we can do inside the actual cloud technologies. So what do we think about? What is a hybrid cloud? Well, really, the cloud represents a huge paradigm shift for us in IT. And really, it's not that big of a difference when you think about it, but it really changes our mindset. I know we're used to having all those servers on premise. We're used to be able to see the lights as they blink. We're used to be able to plug things in and out of our networks, repair hard drives, what they have, and we have all that control. But really, cloud computing has not only changed how we think about IT, it's also gotten us out of that mindset that maybe my servers for a particular type of workload don't need to be on premise. Now, we're not saying that everything has to be moved to the cloud, and that's why we call it a hybrid cloud. It's where you kind of, in a sense, have changed your IT, where you kind of have a foot on both sides, and you have the best of both worlds, where you have your on-premise data center and you can leverage resources in the cloud, and maybe leverage resources like storage or networking components or for disaster recovery. Imagine what if you could tell your closest IT friend, hey, I have a branch data center that's, 400,000 square foot facility and over 100,000 physical servers. Well, essentially, when you use Windows Azure, that's just one of our many data centers that we have around the world. And we have several mega data centers around the world to help service those needs and really scalable workloads. And we've been doing this business for a while. And I know Brad Anderson on his blogs has really talked a lot about the size and the maturity that we have inside of our data centers. But really, a hybrid cloud essentially is an ability for you to bridge from your on-premise data center to a cloud data center and have them connected and have that full functionality. One of the great things when you look at these types of technologies, it really enables you to help solve problems. I mean, I always joke with the customers that I talk to is, what if you were mentioned on a popular TV show like Oprah, for example? Could your front-end web servers handle the possible incoming traffic that you would receive from that just generation of being mentioned on somebody's popularity? And we joke with that, but that's a real possibility. Could you handle that type of traffic? Hybrid clouds can help you kind of get the best of both worlds. And when you look at some of the things, when we think about it from a Microsoft approach, we really want consistency across our clouds. Guess what Windows Azure is built on, folks? It's built on Windows Server. Windows Server 2012, 2012 R2 is at its core. In a sense, when I think about our public cloud environment, when we offer those Azure resources for you, the consumer, to actually use and leverage, it's really just, what is Azure? It's a big giant data center that you can connect to. But the nice thing about being consistent is that the operations that we have inside of our cloud and the things that we do with our servers actually make it easier for us to connect with and work with inside of our environments on premise. And that consistent platform really provides a lot of great things for us, not only when we build our applications or when we back up and control this, but Active Directory on premise versus Active Directory in the cloud, it's just Active Directory, folks. It's a matter of how you connect those and work with that. And we'll see that in the demonstration later into this. Hybrid cloud approach really allow us offer you the ability to optimize your IT resources. And really, folks, this depends on your needs. You're going to have certain data that is never, ever going to go near the cloud. You're going to have certain policies or regulations or certain secret formulas or whatnot. You have something in your premise that, you know what, I need to protect that. That's my company's lifeblood, or it's very important. But that's probably not everything inside your environment. But that's where you can keep that critical data on premise and then use the cloud to provide maybe scaling resources, compute resources, or storage resources inside of there. And really, at the end of the day, it also allows us to network this giant environment. It's also self-service. This is made to order cloud computing. We don't define how the cloud is for you. You define, and the great thing, because we're consistent with the operating system levels and how we connect to this, you determine. This is your made-to-order cloud. We're not going to force you all up into a public environment like some of our competitors do. We're not going to force you just into a pure virtualization environment like other competitors. We're going to let you make the sense, let you make the choice of what makes sense for you and your organization. When you talk to anybody at Microsoft and you talk to people in the server environments, you're going to hear this phrase, we build our servers to be cloud first, or I like to say cloud friendly. And what does that mean? Our servers and our software, from our client software in Windows 8 to Server 2012 R2 to System Center, are all designed to be able to talk and work with the cloud. Does it mean you need them to have a great product? No. Windows Server 2012 by itself, folks, and 2012 R2 is fantastic just in an on-premise environment. But when you start plugging in those cloud components, you start plugging in Azure, you get a lot of abilities that amplify that server so it can really do some demonic things. And really, this is what customers want. So you're going to hear the phrase from Brad. You're going to hear it from everybody inside of Microsoft. We're a cloud first, but we're also customer first, because customers are asking us to help solve these complex real world problems. This is where the cloud really can help enable your data center and take it into that next generation and that next evolution of our technologies that we have. So that's that hybrid cloud that we have inside of our environments. So now let's take a look at why would you choose hybrid cloud and what are some things that we need to look at when we see it. At the end of the day, at any cloud scenario, whether you're going to a pure cloud environment or you're going to a hybrid environment or you're going to a pure on-premise private cloud, why do you choose this? There's only two reasons, really, at the end of everything that we talk about today. You're either going to improve the bottom line, either you're going to save money by leveraging the storage costs in the cloud or be able to scale and provide abilities, or you're going to do things to help improve the strategy of your environments. I've seen customers be able to offload the works of their on-premise SAN into the cloud for a fraction of the cost of what the SANs cost them. Not that they got rid of that SAN, they might have repurposed it for something else, but leveraged it for, once again, that critical workload I keep on-premise and I do other things up in the cloud. Or improve strategy. What if you have a company that relies on data analysis, or maybe you have a certain workload and you have predictive type of bursting where you know maybe you're a retail outlet and you know what's going to happen Cyber Monday, right? Your strategy is if people are going to come to your website, you don't want to have them get the 500 server not found error, right? We want to be able to handle those types of things. Or maybe, like I mentioned earlier, you were mentioned on Oprah, and how do you fix those types of things? So when you look at the reasons to use the cloud and even the reason to use hybrid clouding, it's really two things: to help you save money or improve the strategy or enable a strategy inside your company that you couldn't do otherwise. When we think about this, there are three common scenarios that we're seeing at Microsoft that allow people to use the cloud. First, they might actually use it as an application tier. And when you think about this, what do I mean by that? Well, think about a traditional web application. It's going to have the web front end. It's going to have some kind of middle tier for communication, maybe business rules or analytics inside of it. Then you're going to have a back end for storage. And this might be your database. It might be SQL, might be Oracle, might be something on the back end to store that data. Well, one of the common scenarios that we see customers with hybrid is, you know what, I don't want to stand up 100 web servers. I want to keep the data on-premise, but I'm going to use Azure as my application tier for my web front end. Or, alternatively, I'm going to use Azure as the SQL back end for my application, for whatever that purpose might be. So we can look at Azure as it can provide, not the entire tier. Now, could it do the entire tier? Absolutely. But from our environments, it doesn't have to do that. The other most common scenario, and this one's kind of a natural, hits it out of the ballpark when you think about Windows Azure, is disaster recovery. Imagine when you start saving and working with things, and what if your database happens to be up inside of Azure? What's the great thing about this? Well, what if something really bad happened to your on-premise data center and you couldn't get to the data? Where's the data in the cloud? Now, I know a lot of you, and I'm going to simplify this down to a scenario that probably some of you have done before. How many of you have ever had to redo your phone because maybe the phone broke and you got a brand new phone? And today, with today's technology, and especially with the Windows phones, because I've had this, I've had my phone attack cement, and usually the cement wins over my phone. But where was all my data? It was locked away in the cloud. Was I upset I lost my phone? Sure. But I didn't lose the data. I didn't lose those family photos or the things I took. If you take that into a business scenario, that's what Azure provides for you. It provides kind of an instant disaster recovery environment. So we're going to have your data when it's there. The other one, and the most common scenario that we see a lot of our customers is doing, just simply backup. And that ties in with disaster recovery, but just daily backups. How much storage do you need, and how much storage do you have to purchase for your on-premise environments? Well, imagine the ability just to back up to the cloud and be able to integrate that in with our Windows Server 2012 and 2012 R2 environments. These are scenarios that we're seeing all the time. So being able to back up directly to the cloud is just one of the more common things, and one we'll take a look at today inside the demonstrations. So what are some of the components of a hybrid cloud? And in later presentations, you're going to go into more details, but here, just an overview, there's four of them. And notice the first one, and it's not first by mistake, folks. Windows Server 2012 R2 is the foundation. It is the center of our hybrid cloud environment. Remember what I mentioned earlier. Not only is it our on-premise server, but it has those cloud-friendly, cloud-first kind of design principles baked into its DNA so that when you want to connect to the platform of Windows Azure, it just works. It just knows how to talk and work with the cloud, especially once we start setting up the network for them to make them friendly. But that's the foundation. The other three that are here, Windows Azure, System Center 2012 R2, and the Windows Azure Pack, simply will amplify what 2012 can do for you. Windows Azure, as you know, is our public cloud offering. We offer things in Windows Azure from platform as a services, let your developers just write to a certain application, to infrastructure as a services. Whereas from an IT perspective, we get to stand up our own servers, we get to configure our own servers, and we get connect those servers down to our infrastructure environment. And really, what is Azure built on? It's built on Windows Server 2012. It's at the core of its DNA. We have System Center 2012 for all those management configuration, those maintenance kind of things that we want to do in the cloud. Being able to monitor our cloud services is just as important as being able to monitor our on-premise resources. Now, how cool is System Center? Fundamentally, it doesn't really care where that server is. It's going to monitor that. Once we load agents on those server, they might be in the cloud or they might be on-premise. System Center really doesn't care, although we do have dedicated management packs for Windows Azure. It provides us the ability to do this. And then we have the Windows Azure Pack. This one's actually really exciting, and this is an on-premise type of tool. But a lot of customers, when they started dipping their toes in with our Windows Azure infrastructure services, they really liked our online portal. Well, the Azure Pack essentially is that. It's our Windows Azure online portal that you can actually present and give to your own environment. What does this enable? It's not the full Azure. I mean, we don't give you 100,000 servers in a 400,000 square foot facility, but what we do is we give you that software front-end portal, which you'll see in just a minute if you've never seen it, for your on-premise environment, which provides the ability for you to offer your business self-service design and self-service into your actual private cloud infrastructure. So you can get kind of Azure-like with your on-premise data center. Now, understand this, that when we take a look at hybrid clouds, a lot of people think that a private cloud has to mean all my resources are on-premise. And generally, a private cloud isn't a what. It's really how we do things. It's a process automation. It's how we approach, how do we provide resources to the rest of the business so they can be successful. What it doesn't say, though, is that my private cloud can't include resources that might be outside of the actual premise. It might have storage up in the cloud or SQL up in the cloud. So when we think about this, the Azure Pack just helps provide that self-service environment that we can work at and use. So how do we connect to the hybrid cloud? Well, there's actually a couple of really easy ways to connect. And they actually solve kind of two different problems. The first one is probably the most common one. And if you want to connect your on-premise data center to the Azure data center, you'll create what is known as a site-to-site IPsec VPN tunnel, or just a site-to-site connection. And what this essentially does, it creates a network inside of Azure where we can actually plug in our environments, where we have to have a router that supports this. So we do require a piece of hardware on-premise that supports the IPsec VPN tunnel, which, by the way, folks, there's a list up on our websites that shows you all the routers that are out there, but most modern-day routers will have this component built in. It's just a matter of you configuring it and turning on the actual router. But once that connection is there, once we have that environment, we are now connected to our Azure environment. We're now connected, and we can pass traffic. And if you think about this graphic for a moment, notice I have Active Directory and DNS on-premise, but I also have Active Directory and DNS up in the cloud. What does that mean? What did I just provide my Active Directory environment? First off, people that log on to your network, they're going to log on to on-premise. But what if that on-premise AD is not available? Then where will they be able to go? To the Active Directory in the cloud. And how does it work? It works just like our regular Active Directory. How do you install it? Just like you install your on-premise AD. So from that standpoint, we don't really care where those servers are, but they provide that additional layer of protection. So from a disaster recovery standpoint, I essentially have that Active Directory environment up in the cloud for us via a simple IPsec tunnel. And I'll show you where this is configured in just a minute when we hop into the demo. But imagine that. It's that simple to connect my on-premise network to the Azure network, and I can get all kinds of hybrid facilities using just the built-in networking components. The other one we have, and this is more for management, when you want to manage your Azure environment and configure the servers that are in that environment, you can create what is known as a point-to-site VPN. And this allows your actual clients on the networks to actually be able to connect and manage it as if they were road administrators. I mean, think about it. Unless it's a really hot day, how many of you actually go to your data center to maintain and administer those servers? Probably not often. You probably do it remotely off of a Windows desktop and you remote into that server. Well, that's all a point-to-site VPN is, folks. It's our ability to remote in and manage that Azure network and manage all the servers that are on that network. So we have so many capabilities that once we connect to it. Now, one last thing related to how we look at hybrid networking and how we look at this particular scenario is remote access. When you stand up your virtual machines inside of Azure, that's Hyper-V. Those are Hyper-V images that we have. The best thing about this is if you take a look at the picture here in the CloudNet in the Windows Azure environment, I have some web servers and I have some SharePoint servers. Well, maybe I don't want those SharePoint servers to ever be, I don't want them to be in the cloud right now, or I want to move them out of the environment. You don't even need the IPsec tunnel necessarily to do this, but we don't lock you into our cloud. If you want to move your environment and move them out of the Azure environment on-premise for whatever reason, you can. These are your servers, folks. It's just a matter of you waiting to download those. They're just VHDs. They're just Hyper-V files. And if you have a Hyper-V host on-premise, guess what? You'll be able to bring those servers up online. We don't lock you into those scenarios. It's up to you. Remember we talked about, yeah, we think about the cloud first here at Microsoft, but we also think about you first and foremost. Even though our products are designed like this because customers like yourselves are telling us you want to do these things, it's more important that we give you that control and flexibility to solve the problems the way you need to solve those problems. The other scenario I want to take a look at briefly at, because we're going to see this in demo, and it's kind of important you understand some of the legwork that was done behind the scenes, is backup. Backup is actually pretty easy to do up into Windows Azure. You can use this for Windows Server 2012, 2012 R2, or System Center 2012, or System Center 2012 R2, and specifically with System Center, it's DPM is the product that we currently support, or Windows Server 2012 Essentials and the ability to back it up. Those are the only products we currently support, but how do you work with this, folks? It is so super easy. You first sign up on Azure. You get your Azure account, and by the way, there's a free one-month trial for, it's basically $200 of credit up into our Azure portal that allows you to leverage and give this a try. But you basically sign up. You download agents. Hey, does this sound familiar? What do you do when you back up your own environments? You download those agents to actually work with and save those environments. After you download those agents, you'll register your local servers with the cloud via, and you'll actually register a certificate as well to make sure that we have secure communications, also to make sure that we talk to your location, your specific subscription that's up in the cloud that's there. And that's the big part of the setup. And once we do that, then it's a matter of us just setting a policy. And the policy is just a typical backup policy. I want to back up this folder, this file, and this directories on this day of the week or day of the month, this time, and I want to back it up this frequency. That's it. We're basically setting up the backup schedule and what locations and files we're actually going to back up. We then simply back up the data, either via schedule. You can also just do a quick backup, and it'll automatically back up the data for us to use and leverage. And then the great thing about this, just like many backup scenarios that are out there in the day, all this is locked away in Azure. So what if I were to lose my server or I need to recover the files? So there's a couple choices you have here, my friends. You can actually either recover it to the same server, to the same location, or to the same server in a different location, depending on what you want to do. Or what if that server is not available? Maybe that server did have a fatal crater. Well, what you could do is bring up another server, install the agent on that other physical box, and bring back that recovery down to an alternative server. Now, you might be thinking, well, Matt, you just gave us a lesson inside of backup. In a sense, I did, but where's the location? The big difference here is we're actually going to Windows Azure Backup, specifically locations known as the Backup Vault. Very, very easy. And I'm going to show you what this looks like. And you're thinking, Matt, you're just showing us a backup demo. Remember, don't lose anywhere in this translation where my data is actually being stored, being backed up to, and being recovered from. So let's take a look. And in our demo, we're going to take a look at a couple of concepts. I'm going to show you the basics of just some of the network and the point-to-site VPN and the site-to-site VPN, where those are configured inside the Azure portal. And then I'm going to show you a real live recovery of some documents that are in Azure and show you where that backup portal location is. Well, let's take a look at my demo environment here. And currently I'm logged into my Azure portal and I'm just on the all items. So I see everything that's currently inside my portal, from some virtual machines like I have with Dallas 1 to my different cloud environments. And notice if I click on Dallas 1, it takes me there. I have my backup vault, which we'll take a look at in just a moment. But one thing that I don't have created yet is a virtual network. Now, just real briefly, a virtual network is something that I can create up inside of Azure. It allows me to control the IP address ranges that are assigned to the virtual machines that I create. So whenever you create a virtual machine inside of Azure, they are DHCP enabled machines, and they're always going to be that way. But virtual networks allow you to control that address range that's going to be assigned to those virtual machines when they actually come online and for us to work with it. Now, that's at a real high level. Virtual networks are going to be assigned to a certain data center and data region, whatever you create when you set it up. But for our purposes today, when we talk about hybrid networking, virtual networks really is the building block that allows us to connect and create that bridge between our on-premise data centers and our Azure data center. And this is how we create it. So let me just take you through the wizard. I'm just going to step through. I'm not actually going to create a virtual network for this particular demo, but I just want to show you where some of those configuration settings are. So I'm just going to call this hybrid one. And I'm going to create a new Infinity group just so you can see what that's like. An Infinity group essentially is a container where I can put all the different components for whatever that application might be, what servers, network, storage, whatnot. I'm going to choose one of our data centers here, mega data centers in the West. And if you really want to know where that probably is, down in San Antonio, Texas, I'm just going to give it a name. It's called Hybrid 1. And click on Next. Now, how do I start hybrid networking? Well, the first thing I mentioned, whenever we create virtual machines inside of Azure, a default a remote desktop connection is created for you to be able to remote in and maintain that. But if you have 500 servers up there, you essentially would have 500 RDP connections, which, by the way, you can delete if you don't need them. But if those 500 servers are on a particular virtual network, all I have to do is create one point-to-site VPN network, and this allows my clients to manage that data center as if they would manage an on-premise data center, that it's the same kind of consistent approach, and we essentially are just VPN-ing to this virtual network that we have in Azure that has all of my servers connected to it, and allows me to really configure and maintain that by checking the box and modifying some security settings. We're basically saying what address ranges we're going to give to those clients, so when they come in, they can actually maintain the environment. The other one that's here, and I'm going to clear that box for this one, is what is called the site-to-site VPN. Now, the site-to-site VPN allows you to connect your on-premise network to your Azure network with a IPsec VPN tunnel. Remember, I mentioned earlier in the presentation, you actually have to set this up first, and most modern routers will have this turned on. And what you actually have to do is, on your actual on-premise device, is simply configure the IPsec tunneling and then know that IP address of that actual router, and then essentially just plug it in here, and it's going to tie into that network for us to work with it. Now, you can only have one site-to-site tunnel per Azure network, but you can have up to 5 networks per Azure subscription. What's interesting about that is that I've only seen one customer use actually just 2 Azure networks. So 5 might seem fairly small, but based on the fact that we support Class A, Class B, and Class C address subnets with inside each virtual network, you really have a huge amount of IP address space to leverage and use and still be able to create those subnets, create those different types of LANs and VLANs that you want to create inside of our environment. So for our perspective, it's just a matter of, once you set up the device, of knowing that device's IP address and give it a name, and that's all you have to do to begin that hybrid networking. And once that connection's established between your on-premise network and your Azure cloud, now it's just a remote data center. It's a remote data center that happens to be a 400,000 square foot facility with a little over 100,000 computers in it for you to leverage. The other demo that I want to show you while you're here is I want to take you through a quick tour of the Windows Azure backup. Now, we saw that I have my backup vault created inside of Azure, and if I look at it, I have my recovery services and have my backup vault, and really all it does is show me what my certificates are, what protected items that I have here, but notice I only see servers that are here. I don't actually see the file folders. Well, how do I access that information? Well, this is where the backup client, the backup and recovery client comes in. Remember, before we can use this, we have to download and install the agent. And when you do that, you actually get your backup services. So here I am actually in the Windows Server Backup utility. And you notice over here I have local backup, and then I have backup. Now, if you look at backup, it has a cute little cloud icon for us to see and use and leverage. And all that does, it says I'm a Windows Azure backup. But even notice that when I'm highlighted on top of it, it even says in the title bar that this is Windows Azure backup. Now, what are some things that I had to do before this? The first thing, and I already mentioned, is I had to actually register the server, which essentially tells me where my certificate is. You have to have an encryption certificate. You can use a self-signed cert if you want to, or you can actually leverage whatever PKI solution you're using for certificate. And then it's a matter of stepping through and saying, hey, this server knows how to talk to my backup vaults. I've already done that, so I don't need to do that now. I've also set up my backup environment. If I click on schedule backup, what it's doing is pulling the policy down from Azure. So the policy is actually stored up there, and it tells me what area I've decided to back up. So I've backed up my eCloud backup directory. And if I show you what that directory looks like here, if I just go to eCloud backup, I just have a couple text files, nothing real major, just some real small files that are up there for us to work with it. And then I can specify the backup time. This will be my reoccurring schedule, my retention time. We actually create snapshots. So we kind of do, in a sense, previous versions up in the cloud. So we can actually have multiple copies up there for us based on what we have set up. Do I have any, I also can set up exclusions if I need to. That was actually backup on here. If I want to add dates and times, I can add in different items. I can exclude items. I can really control what I back up. But folks, you're thinking, wait, Matt, this is just like pretty much every backup tool I've used. That's the point. The only difference is, and it's an important difference here, folks, is that I'm actually backing up into the cloud. So I'm going to go ahead and cancel out of this because I've already created my backups. And I can back up now if I want. It'll actually back up the environment. Or I can simply, let's say, recover data. Now, to prove that I'm going to do a live recovery here, let me show you my desktop on my server. Let me just minimize a couple things. So notice I have nothing on my desktop, and I'm going to bring files down from the cloud. Actually, really easy to do here, folks. So I'm going to go ahead and click on recover data. It tells me where do I want to recover it, this server or another. I'm going to recover it to this server. It's going to say, how do I want to relook for the files? I'm just going to browse for the files because I don't have a lot. You can do some searching there if you do have quite a few files up there to look at or bring down. I'm just going to choose the volume, which is the volume E that I've backed up. It's going to ask, which one do you want to bring up? I'm just going to bring the one up from that I created today. And I'm going to scroll down through that list. It takes a second to retrieve the list. We'll bear with it here just a moment. And notice it comes up, tells me my cloud backup directory, and then brings the file. So I'm going to just bring down my actual file, one of my favorite football teams, the Ohio State Buckeyes. For everybody out there, OH. And for you Buckeye fans, you get what I'm talking about. So I'm just going to click on Next. It's going to ask, where do I want to put it, original location? I'm going to say another location. I'm just going to browse to my desktop here. Click OK. It's going to tell it where it's going to have. Do I want to create copies, overwrite, depending on where I'm bringing this in? Do I want to bring back ACLs? I can do that. And I'm just going to go ahead and click on Recover. Now, this will take just a minute. It's actually initializing a connection. It's estimating the size of the backup items. I found that sometimes this isn't always the most accurate when it comes up with a size prediction, but it is going to bring back the file. It should take just a second here for this file to come back up. So we're going to let it chug here and hopefully bring back down the file from the cloud. And notice the file came back, 1K was transferred. I'm going to go ahead and click on Close. And just to prove to you that the file is there, let me go ahead and minimize my window down. And there is my e-volume. If I open it up, Cloud Backup, and there's my file. Go Buckeyes. Woohoo! And with that, you can see how easy it is to leverage some of those hybrid cloud scenarios. Very, very easy things to do. And if you look to my blog, I actually have some step-by-step guides that I'll create a link here for you that can actually show you how to actually do that online backup for yourself. Thank you for watching this screencast and this presentation on the Microsoft Virtual Academy. Make sure to check out more classes that are out there on the MVA. I know there's several inside the hybrid cloud, so you can check out all those done by some wonderful peers of mine. If you want to try some things yourself, check out the TechNet Virtual Labs. And also, if you want to download some of the products like Windows Server 2012 R2 or System Center 2012 R2, please to make sure to visit the TechNet Evaluation Center. Thank you. Thank you for watching, and have a great day.